Okay, so we have Dr. Philip Colucci. He's from Hospital for Special Surgery. He's going to talk to us about brachial plexus. Welcome, Philip.
Thank you very much. Again, my name is Philip Colucci. I'm from Hospital for Special Surgery, and I'm going to spend the 15 minutes talking about primarily just the brachial plexus, and the goal is to kind of go through what we do and some interesting cases along the way. I don't have any personal disclosures, but HSS does have institutional research agreements with both GE Healthcare as well as Siemens Medical Solutions, but I've tried to make this talk as vendor neutral as possible. I was also the recipient of an RSNA fellow research grant in 2020. That was sponsored by Siemens, and the purpose of this project was to build a high-resolution MR neurography atlas of the brachial plexus and upper extremity nerves. So this work can be freely accessed with this link right here, so I'll give a little bit of plug. I think this is really helpful. So this is our general protocol. This was published from our institution recently, and then I'll just show also a few cases along the way that I hope you find interesting. So in general, we prefer 3T over 1.5T whenever possible. The higher SNR is going to allow for faster acquisition as well as higher spatial resolution. Using a wide bore magnet allows us to position the patient so that the brachial plexus is as close to isocenter as possible. So this will give maximal field homogeneity as well as gradient linearity and also more homogeneous fat suppression. Stronger gradients will allow for decreased echo spacing, and this is going to increase image sharpness. And it's also important to have a system that can bind different coils, because as far as I know, there's not a dedicated brachial plexus coil that's been developed yet. And then the new artificial intelligence and deep learning tools are also going to improve image quality and decrease acquisition time. So in terms of coil selection, we initially tried this neurovascular coil. We found that it was too rigid. It didn't provide enough lateral coverage, and overall, the SNR was just too low. Next, we were looking at the torso coil. It didn't really fare much better. It's somewhat flexible, but it didn't allow for positional changes. The neck coverage was too poor, and the signal was still inadequate. So what we found to work the best is a combination of two phased array flexible surface coils. These coils conform better to the curvature of the neck and shoulder. They can be positioned to get enough coverage, enough signal of both the neck and the arm, and the overall SNR has been pretty good. The one downside is that this setup really only allows us to image one side at a time, but even if we're doing a bilateral study, we find that it's worth the extra time to do one side at a time. So for the brachial plexus, we typically acquire one plane with intermediate weighting, and this is going to provide a good overview of the patient's anatomy with a slightly higher spatial resolution. And our T2 weighted fat suppressed sequences, we will acquire in both the long and short axis to the nerve, or whichever nerves are in question. And it's important to realize that T2 weighting is not only going to provide good nerve contrast, but it also provides valuable information about the regional musculature. So on the left, you can see this curved MIP image showing the suprascapular nerve in long axis. And there are multiple severe constrictions in the setting of Parsonage-Turner syndrome. And on the right, you can see that there is increased signal in both the supraspinatus and infraspinatus muscles, which is often seen in the setting of active denervation. So we prefer an echo time of between 60 and 85 milliseconds. Any lower doesn't really provide sufficient T2 weighting to be able to reliably identify muscle edema or nerve pathology. And higher echo times just end up with too little signal. There are many types of fat suppression techniques, and these are the three that we most commonly employ. Fat saturation is relatively fast, but it is more sensitive to field inhomogeneity. STIR is more robust for fat suppression, and we tend to use this for our 3D sequences. And we will use primarily Dixon for our 2D acquisitions in short axis. It's a little bit more motion sensitive, but it tends to provide better spatial resolution. These images show the nerve roots. So this is more high up in the neck, and the scan times for each echo train length. A 9-minute sequence tends to produce too much motion. Our patients just can't sit still for that long. And the longer echo train length is much faster, but you end up with too much T2 blurring. So we found that an echo train length of around 130 is kind of that middle ground that gives us the an adequate image quality and reasonable scan time. But even with these relatively short scan times, respiratory motion can still render images completely non-diagnostic. So with the prospective respiratory triggering, you can markedly improve image quality, but it doesn't always work out as well as you would expect, especially if the patient doesn't naturally breathe with a very regular rate. And then respiratory triggering will also increase scan time, even more so when patients tend to breathe slowly. But the image quality improvement is often worth the time penalty. So in this case, it's almost impossible to distinguish anatomy from artifact. But on the right, you can see that there's a relatively large peripheral nerve sheath tumor involving the posterior cord. Now, imaging around metal can be very difficult, and we see a lot of hardware because I work for an orthopedic hospital. But even in this situation, we still prefer to image at 3T if at all possible. So in this image, you can see that the imaging above as well as below the hardware is still giving diagnostic images, but the metal artifact in this situation does obscure the brachial plexus. So this is where multispectral imaging is still going to allow us to image the patient at 3T. And what we can see here is that there's segmental enlargement and hyperintensity of the plexus at the level that was previously obscured. And given the morphology and course of the plexus in this region, we felt that this was much more likely to be sequelae of a stretch injury as opposed to hardware impingement. In this case, we have a resurfacing shoulder arthroplasty, and it's causing marked susceptibility. And you'll notice that the fat and water images have been swapped. And this is due to off-resonant signal that confuses the Dixon algorithm. And it may not be an issue if your techs routinely send both images, because you can just read off the fat sequence. But we tend not to do that. So in this case, multispectral imaging is not only going to decrease the metal artifact, but it's also going to ensure that you get proper fat suppression. Now, vascular suppression can markedly improve nerve conspicuity in and around the plexus. And gadolinium works by shortening both the T1 and T2 relaxation times of intravascular blood. For STIR, the T1 shortening is going to be the dominant effect, though, because the post-contrast blood has a T1 relaxation curve that's very similar to fat. And the nearly identical null points result in vascular suppression that is basically as effective as the fat suppression. The T2 shortening is also going to decrease signal given the long TE, but this is a lesser effect, excuse me. So in this example, with two MIP images, the suprascapular nerve is nearly obscured on the pre-contrast image, but is very clearly identified after administering IV gadolinium. This is another case of Parsons-Turner syndrome, and there's multiple severe constrictions of the suprascapular nerve. Now, we've also found that low-dose furmoxidil has also been an excellent agent for vascular suppression. Furmoxidil is also going to shorten both T1 and T2 relaxation times, but in this case, it's really more the strong T2 star effect that dominates for vascular suppression. We also found that increased nerve-to-muscle signal nerve-to-muscle contrast was being observed, and this was thought to be due to suppression of the microvasculature. The main downside to using ferumoxidil clinically is that it has to be injected very slowly, and that patients have to be monitored for physiologic and allergic reactions, which are very rare, and overall, this is probably at least as safe as gadolinium. So in this example with ferumoxidil, you can see that the slow-flowing venous blood, even in larger veins along the walls, is going to have similar signal and size characteristics as the nearby nerves. And after infusion of ferumoxidil, there's essentially complete vascular suppression. So we did use this ferumoxidil for the ATLAS project because it's a blood pool agent and it has a long half-life around 14 hours. So we were able to bring patients back for a second day of imaging. If someone did a really, really good job, we wanted to get more imaging. That's another benefit of ferumoxidil. The other thing we leaned heavily on for the Atlas development was a deep learning algorithm that, and we used it primarily to boost spatial resolution. We use DL Recon, which is a GE product, but every vendor has their own 3D and or 2D sequences. I think some of the 3D sequences may not be product yet. But, you know, just broadly speaking, this technology is going to work on the raw data, and it substantially denoises the final images. This is an example of the sciatic nerve, but it's the best one that I have. And we found that the outer epineurium and fascicular architecture specifically are much easier to appreciate on these reconstructed images. Now, you will get more pulsation and ghosting artifacts, unfortunately, but we found that it typically doesn't hinder the nerve imaging too much. And this is the last example I have of Parsonage-Turner syndrome, and this is just meant to show how much denoising can really improve image quality. And clinically speaking, when we are using DL Recon, we're primarily using it to decrease scan time. So this is an overview of our protocol. We start with an axial intermediate weighted sequence. We then acquire a straight coronal T2 Dixon, and both of these sequences are meant to provide more of a broad overview of the patient's anatomy. Next, we acquire two oblique sagittal sequences in short axis to the plexus. The upper batch, we tend to use Dixon fat suppression, and the lower batch, we use a T2 fat saturated sequence. Then we run an oblique coronal 3D stir, which is going to be in long axis to the plexus. And all of our cases are being checked by a radiologist in real time. So if needed, we'll decide to administer contrast on a case-by-case basis. We may also obtain additional imaging planes with 2D sequences through specific nerves, such as the long thoracic nerve, which tends to course more inferiorly, or the suprascapular nerve more laterally. But most of the time, we can make a diagnosis just based on the 3D acquisition. We also have a dedicated protocol for thoracic outlet syndrome. So this will add two additional oblique sagittal intermediate weighted sequences, and they're obtained in the neutral as well as the abduction and external rotation positions. And one of the things that we're evaluating and what we include in a report is the costoclavicular distance on both these sequences. And we don't routinely acquire this, but sometimes we will also add a 3D ZTE sequence. And the benefit of the ZTE is that, you know, after all the post-processing, you can get something that's nearly equivalent to CT, and it can make the osseous anatomy much easier to delineate. So in this case, there's a developmental anomaly with pseudarthrosis involving the first and second ribs. There's also mildly increased signal within the plexus in this region. So volume rendering of the ZTE sometimes helps our surgeons in terms of planning or visualization, what they expect to see when they go in. And the data from the 3D stir can also be combined, and this can be helpful in surgical planning or patient education. So I'll end with just a few interesting cases of iatrogenic injuries. The first case, we have a 29-year-old woman. She has a shoulder injury, a dislocation event, and subsequent shoulder instability. And she was treated with capsular and labral repair, as well as a biceps tenodesis, but subsequently developed wrist drop and finger weakness. So on the left, we have a 2D image, and on the right is a MIP of a 3D stir sequence. And on both images, you can see that the median nerve is markedly enlarged and hyperintense. On the right, I've also labeled the radial nerve, so that acts as a nice normal comparison, internal control. And the area of focal narrowing was surgically confirmed to be a suture that had inadvertently captured the median nerve, so that was released. In this second case, I have a 39-year-old man presenting with avulsion of the glenohumeral ligament from its humeral attachment. He underwent arthroscopic repair, but he was left with a dense axillary nerve palsy. This MIP image shows an enlarged and hyperintense axillary nerve, and it takes an abnormal course superiorly as it approaches the humeral neck. So we suspected that this was scar entrapment of the axillary nerve. And the image on the right here is a normal comparison showing the expected course of the axillary nerve. So these intraoperative photographs, which are courtesy of one of our surgeons, Dr. Wolf, the image on the right shows that deep to the pectoralis major, the axillary nerve was found to be scar entrapped and tethered to the subscapularis. And for the last case, I have a 17-year-old. She had a coracoclavicular disruption. This was also treated arthroscopically with an allograft. but she unfortunately developed weakness and atrophy in the suprascapular nerve distribution. Additional imaging shows that the suprascapular nerve is enlarged and hyperintense, and this focus of linear low signal represents the allograft that had unfortunately been passed around and entrapped the suprascapular nerve. So in this case, the orthopedic surgeon just opted to go in and yank out one limb of the graft, and luckily the patient had a good outcome. She had significant recovery of her strength, and also the graft remained stable for her. So these are my references. I want to give special thanks to Dr. Sneeg, who has functioned as a mentor for me, both formally and informally, and Dr. Tan is one of our MR physicists on our team. So he works very closely with us on multiple clinical and research applications, and every time I get to chat with him, I'm always learning something new. So thank you very much. This is my email. Feel free to reach out to me anytime, and I will do my best to field any questions if you have some now. Yes?
Excellent talk. Thank you. It was very interesting that you mentioned the use of ferumoxytol. Are there particular situations in which you're using ferumoxytol versus gadolinium? Are there particular patients? And are you, do you find that your results so far are achieving better vascular suppression with ferumoxytol?
So the question is, which patients would we use ferumoxytol instead of gadolinium, and are there benefits of ferumoxytol over gadolinium? So right now we don't use ferumoxytol clinically. I can't think of a single case that we have, and that's largely just because of the infusion time. It takes 15 minutes. So that's, once you do all your pre-contrast imaging, gadolinium is a quick push. Ferumoxytol, you have to tie up the scanner for another 15 minutes, so it's not feasible from a workflow perspective. So one thing we are looking at now is the kind of the minimum dose that's needed, right? So it's a blood pool agent. So theoretically, smaller patients, we could give an even lower dose. That may make this a little bit more feasible. So we were giving about 1/4 of a dose of one infusion. So that takes 15 minutes. So if we can get, and that lasted for about 22 hours, right? So if we could cut the infusion time maybe down to 2 or 3 minutes, then maybe that would be reasonable. But that's our limitation right now. But I think ferumoxytol works at least equivalent to gadivist.
So
great, thank you.
There's a question. You're saying, can you please put up the Atlas website address?
Oh, sure, absolutely.
Or maybe they can reach out to you by
email. Absolutely, yes, please. I will be more than happy to. Let's see if I can just get back to the beginning quickly. I don't want to fly through all of this. This is the problem with putting in all the animations. Is there a faster way to do this?
You can escape.
Escape, go back to the beginning? Okay. Here we go. Okay. So it's pretty straightforward. It's just hss.edu/mrnatlas, and that'll bring you to the landing page. And I still use this. I mean, I put the Atlas together. I came up with all the labeling, and I still have to refer back to it to remind myself, oh, yeah, this is where that goes. These are the anatomic landmarks, and this is what's this is the innervation is what I find to still be challenging, what's being innervated by what.
All right.
Thank you very much.